Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Edinburgh International Book Festival. My name is Roland Gulliver. I'm the Associate Director of the festival. I'm delighted to welcome you here for a very, very special event. Tonight's event marks the culmination of a very special strand of events that we've done as part of this year's programme, with the support, the very grateful and much appreciated support of the Wellcome Trust, called Conversations with Ourselves, created in partnership with the University of Durham. We've been exploring many aspects of hearing voices and the phenomenon of voice hearing from through mental illness to childhood friends to the creative voices that writers hear when they write their books and create their stories. And tonight's event is a culmination of all those ideas and all those thoughts and that's been going on for the past 2 weeks. In addition to that, it's also the launch of a book by the Moth, which will be published today. It's been launched today. It's a very special event. So we're delighted that the culmination of a brilliant project and a brilliant book has come together for what will be a brilliant night. The Moth is a very, very special thing. It's very, very difficult to describe, but it's a very, very powerful and moving and funny and inspiring invention. And so without further ado, I shall welcome your host for the evening. Please welcome Lynn Ferguson.
Thanks, Roland. Oh, hello. Oh, you're looking gorgeous tonight, aren't you? Lovely, nice to see you. Now, welcome to the Moth. The theme for tonight is hearing voices, and as you can hear, I've got festival lurgy. So it was kind of ironic, because it was nearly Helen Keller doing the hosting tonight. I can't see and I can't speak either. So welcome, welcome, welcome to the Moth. Now, before we do anything, by the way, can I tell you, I used to host stand-up, and the reason that I changed from stand-up to the Moth is this. Weep, ladies and gentlemen, you'll never see a stand-up with a clipboard. Look at me. Anyway, so what I'm going to say to you is, first thing, if you've got a mobile phone, and who doesn't, go turn it off now. I know you think that you've turned it off, but just check for me, because the thing about it, right, is, and check for yourselves, quite frankly, right? Because it's been busy. Edinburgh's busy. There's too many hills, right? You don't have a cell phone, do you? You don't have a cell phone? Good news to you. I tell you, I feel like having a cell phone sometimes is a bit like being heckled by your family. Do you know what I mean? Anyway, that was my family laughing because they know, right? So, have a wee rummage about, turn off your things. Now, is there anybody who knows nothing about the Moth? Is it all right? So everybody knows everything about the Moth, then? That's what it is. Is there anybody in here afraid of raising their hands? So is there anybody here who doesn't know anything about the Moth? I'm not going to pick on you or anything, right? See, quite a lot, actually, quite a lot. And everybody else knows lots about the Moth. Oh, you're turning them off so I can't see anybody. That's my director. Yeah, right. So, well, what I'll tell you, if you've I know, not now, I'm fired. Right, no, if you've never done, I've never seen anything about the Moth, then I have to disappoint you. There's not going to be a giant moth, right? Tonight, there isn't going to be a giant moth comes on the stage, and it isn't going to be all of us sitting in a room looking at a real moth. Now, I say this because in Edinburgh, both of those are possibilities. What it is the Moth is getting, God, it's getting darker. Is it getting darker or is my illness getting worse? Is it? Right, I'm like, oh, are the orcs coming? What's going on? Right, anyway, so what it is a story. It's a storytelling, I was going to say conglomerate, but that sounds weird, doesn't it? It makes it sound like a wee cult. It's a storytelling group that comes from New York. And actually, I kind of bumped into them through the slams, and they're awesome. And the main thing you need to know about the stories is they're true, right? So there's not any kind of fancy, dancy, changing it around thing. The stories are true. They're told without notes, apart from me, because I have the clipboard. And they're about 10 minutes long. And as Roland said, we have the book out, The Moth, The True Story, which is... Can you hear how breathy I am? It's terrible, isn't it? I'm not even nervous, I'm just sick. And yes, thank you for your sympathy, Moth audience. Anyway, so there's no cheat sheets, and it's all true stories. And each story has to be around 10 to 12 minutes. And Neil here... I do love a name that is also a command. Do you know what I mean? Because I catch myself at the moment, right? Because I'm feeling a bit sick and I'm quite high on cold meds, right? And it is just cold meds. I went Neil here to him, and in my head I was like, I could see him going to Neil. I do the same with Pat. Do you know what I mean? And I have to be really careful with Roger. Right, anyway. So bad, right? So Neil is a timekeeper, right? And what he'll do, right, so if a storyteller hasn't wrapped up and needs to think about wrapping up, you know, needs to hurry up a bit, he'll play this note. Oh, frisky. And that means that they've got, like, they need to, you know, be thinking about finishing off. And if they've really kind of really overrun, what are you going to play? Ooh, cocky. That's the tune from Countdown, in case you didn't know this. So, as I say tonight, you're going to do that tune for me. So the theme tonight is hearing voices. And I think that's a good theme. And it's good for me, actually, because I feel like there's... Like, I am Scottish, obviously, but I live in LA. And I worried about comparing tonight or hosting tonight. I was really concerned about it because of the Lulu syndrome. I don't know if you know what that is, right? But when Lulu, who's a singer, moved to America and came back and did Parkinson, my mother was like, would you listen to her? Right? Would you listen to her? Because she'd do stuff like she'd like talk like Lulu, and then she'd go, yeah, and I just had some tomatoes, right? You go, you're not even American. Everybody knows where you're from. So I am most afraid of talking like Lulu. And but I might tonight, because I've found out in America you have to a little bit talk like Lulu. So in Lulu's defense, you have to. And I found that out when I moved there. Because that, like, you know, Americans don't pay union subs, they pay dues, right? Like Jews or dues, right? And dues is one of those words where I was like, I'm not saying that, that's tomato, right? So I phoned up my union. And I said, can you put me through to the Jews department, please? And there was, like, silence, right? I'm like, man, what's wrong with you? I said, I need to pay the Jews. So now I say dues, okay? So if I have odd Americanisms tonight, I'm sorry, I am not being Lulu. You can secretly judge me, right? And hold me in resentment. But I want you to understand my point of view. Is that okay with you, Moth audience? Good. Is there any questions? If there are, keep them to yourself and ask me later. We've only got an hour. Right. So, we're going to go straight on with the first storyteller. Now, we always at the Moth, we don't bother doing the, like, you know, here's what they've done, here's how important they are, here's why you should be impressed. We ask them a question that's with the theme of the show, right? So the show tonight is Hearing Voices. So we asked each of our storytellers, whose voice do you love hearing? And whose voice do you never want to hear again? Tell you, Elvis is mine. I mean, that I want to hear. I'm not going to say who I never want to hear. You probably are all going, I never want to hear that Scottish Lulu girl again. Her with a bad voice. So I asked our next storyteller, Andrew Solomon, And he said, the voice of his child, George Charles Hobbit Sullivan, is who he most likes to hear. And he never wants to hear again, Sarah Palin. He may be American, ladies and gentlemen, but he's just like us. All right, now please welcome onto the stage. Sorry, I've got Steve Osborne here. Did you write Steve Osborne? Did you do that to trick me up? Okay. Please welcome onto the stage the fantastic Andrew Solomon.
I'm not depressed now, but I was depressed for quite a long time, and it was catastrophic and overwhelming and made a misery out of a section of my life. And as I began to emerge from depression and decided to write a book about the experience, I began researching treatments for depression. And I started off as a real medical conservative with the view that the only things that had been proven to work were medication, certain forms of talk therapy, and in extreme cases, electroshock treatments. And then I started getting letters from people who had read things I'd written and were writing to me about the things they'd experienced. And I realized that if you have brain cancer, and you say that standing on your head for half an hour every morning makes you feel better, it may make you feel better, but you still have brain cancer, and you'll still most likely die from it. But if you have depression, and you say it makes you feel better to stand on your head for half an hour every morning, then you're cured. Because depression is an illness of how you feel, and if you feel better, you're not depressed anymore. So I opened up to the wide world of experimental treatments, and I got dozens and dozens, hundreds actually, of letters from people writing to tell me about treatments. My particular favorite came from a woman who told me that she had tried medication, she had tried psychotherapy, she had even tried electroconvulsive therapy, and she had finally found the thing that worked for her, and she hoped I would share the story with the world, and that was making little things from yarn. She sent me some of them, and I'm not wearing them now. As I explored this world of alternative treatments, I happened to be talking at one point to my friend David Hecht, who had moved to Senegal at that stage. And he said, you know, there are tribal rituals for the treatment of mental illness, and especially of depression, here in Senegal. And, you know, if you wanted to research them, why don't you come over and we'll see what we can set up? And I said, well, that would be fascinating. I would love to learn more about that. So off I flew to Senegal, and I met, David came and met me at the airport with his then-girlfriend, now ex-wife, Hélène. And Hélène had a friend who was a cousin of the mother of someone who went to school with the aunt of an associate of someone who actually performed the ritual I had come to learn about, the Undop. And so through that rather bizarre lineage, I was able to connect with someone who practiced it and go and interview her, which was a fantastic opportunity. So we went off to the small town where this woman lived, village really, and we went into her hut, and she was there. Her name was Madame Dioff, and she was wearing fabric patterned with images of eyes, miles and miles and miles of this fabric. And we sat down and we had a long interview, and I asked her all about the Undop, and she explained various things, and I said, oh, that's very helpful, and oh, how interesting, and took some notes. And then we finished, and somewhat emboldened, I said to her, is there any chance that I could actually come and see an Undop being performed? And she said, well, I've certainly never had a foreigner, the local word was tubob, I've never had a tubob actually come to see one, she said, but you've come through friends and you're serious about this, so yes, I think you could. You can come the next time I do one. And I said, that's fantastic. I said, and when will you next be doing one? And she said, oh, sometime in the next 6 months. And I said, 6 months is quite a long time for me to stay here waiting for you to do one. And I wondered whether there was anyone I could maybe help expedite their procedure. She said, no, it really doesn't work that way. And so I said, well, I'm sorry I won't get to see Inundup, but I'm so glad I got to meet you and talk to you. And just as we were leaving the hut, she said, I hope you don't mind my saying this. And I said, no, what? And she said, you don't look that great yourself. She said, are you suffering from depression? And I said, yes. I said, it's better than it was, but I suffer from it a bit. And she said, well, she said, I've certainly never done this for a two-bob before, but I could do an end-up for you. And I said, oh, what an interesting idea. Yes, why not? Let's do that. Let's have an end-up for me. And we left, and Hélène turned to me and she said, are you completely crazy? Do you have any idea what you're getting yourself into? And I said, I think it'll be fine. I think it'll be really interesting. And she said, you're crazy, but I will help you if you would like me to. So we had been given a list of supplies we had to bring back when we came for the performance of the Undop. And over the next couple of days, we went to markets to get all of the supplies. We got 7 yards of fabric. We got a kilo of sugar. We got a great deal of millet, which is a grain. We got kola beans. We had to get a calabash, which is a big bowl made from a gourd. And then on the list were 2 live cockerels and a ram. And we got the 2 live cockerels, and it was the day before the thing, and I said to Hélène, she said, okay, we can go home now, and I said, but what about the ram? And she said, well, we can't buy the ram today. What are we going to do with it overnight? So I saw the sense in that. And I said, okay, and she said, we'll see a ram on our way there tomorrow. So the next day, we got up, we got into a taxi cab, we headed out toward this little town that was a few hours away from Dakar, and indeed, along the side of the road, we passed a Senegalese shepherd. And Hélène said, oh, this'll do. And we got out, and we negotiated with him, and he sold us the ram for $7. And then we had a slightly difficult time getting the ram into the boot of the taxi. And the ram, who didn't seem particularly thrilled with this arrangement, relieved himself all over the bottom of the boot of the taxi. The driver didn't seem to mind. We got that all taken care of. Drove out to where we were going, and there was Madame Diouf, and we got out with all our supplies, and someone took the ram away, and she had 5 assistants, 5 other women who were with her there who were going to be involved. And she said, to begin with, she said, you have to take off what you're wearing and put on a loincloth. So I did that. And then the undup is a ritual in which the structure varies enormously. It's not consistent in what it looks like. And in this instance, I had to take a group of objects and hold them and let them fall, and hold them and let them fall, and they interpreted the patterns, and then my arms were rubbed with millet, and we were going through all of these bits and pieces, and someone said, you know, we really should have music. And I thought, oh, drumming, African drumming, there's nothing more beautiful that will make this such a romantic experience. And this woman disappeared into her hut and came out with her prized possession, which was a battery-operated tape player for which she had 1 tape, Chariots of Fire. So Chariots of Fire went on playing, and I went on dropping these objects in various directions and so on. All seemed to be going very pleasantly so far. And then at a certain point, she said, okay, we've now done the readings, and it's now time for the main part to begin. And I said, oh. And suddenly there was the sound of drumming, that African drumming that I had been so hoping for. And the drumming began, boom, boom, boom. And they led me to the central square of this village, where there was a makeshift wedding bed that I had to get into with the ram. And I was told it would be very, very bad luck if the ram got away, so I had to hold him very tightly, which he was also not so thrilled about. And dancing around us in concentric circles were all of the people of the village who had all taken the day off from work to come and be part of this. None of them were out in the fields. And so they were going around and around, and as they did, they were throwing sheets of fabric over the ram and me. And it was incredibly hot. And underneath there, it was unbelievably stifling. And then they started beating us with something. And I thought, what is going on? I later found out they were beating us with the cockerels, like that. So there we were, under all this cloth, being beaten by these cloths, and the ram and I. The ram, of course, urinated on my leg. And then at a certain key moment, all of this fabric was yanked away. I was pulled to my feet. The ram and the cockerels had their throats slit. My loincloth was pulled off, and I was completely covered in the blood of the freshly slaughtered animals. And then they said, okay, that's the end of this part. And I said, what now? And they said, well, why don't you come over here? They said, you know, it's getting to be lunchtime. We should maybe take a little break. And I said, okay. And I was beginning to get covered with flies, which is what happens when you're naked and covered in fresh animal blood. So somebody said to me, would you like a Coke? I don't drink a lot of Coke, but at that particular moment, it seemed like a really excellent idea. So I had my Coke, and then they said, okay, they said, now we'll go on with the next part of the ritual. They said, you have to stand very straight and tall. And the ram had been hung in a tree nearby, and there were people butchering it, and they were putting some pieces down on the ground. And I stood very straight and tall, and they took the ram's intestines and tied up my arms and legs and all around my body with the intestines of the ram. And so I was standing there, and then they said, okay, now you have to come over here. So I had to sort of shuffle over. I don't know whether any of you have ever tried to walk when tied in ram's intestines, but it's not so easy. So I walked over, and I got to that spot, and there were three little piles of meat from the ram. And I then had to do something that was actually, I thought, incredibly touching. I had to dig holes, and I had to put these pieces of meat into the holes, and I had to say something. And the idea here, which had been explained to me earlier on, is that in Senegal, you have spirits sort of all over you, the way that we have microbes and things. And the reason, apparently, that I had had the problems I'd had was that my evil spirits were jealous of my real-life sexual partners, some of whom are here tonight. And so now what I had to do to mollify the spirits was, in fact, to bury these things. And I had to say as I buried each of them, spirits, leave me to complete the business of my life and know that I will never forget you. And I remember thinking how strangely touching that was to say to your evil spirits, know that I will never forget you. And I never have. So we finished that. And then they untied me, and then they said, okay, they said, it's mostly done now. All we have to do is to wash off the blood. And I said, great. And then all of these five women began filling their mouths with water and spitting it all over me, and then rubbing me down in between with towels and things. It was the kind of surround shower effect. And when they'd finished that, they said, you can put back on your clothes. And I put on my jeans and my T-shirt, and there was a huge barbecue with the ram, and all the people who had been dancing around and had been part of this all came. And I felt so up. I thought, okay, I don't know what the principles are behind this, and I don't believe in the animist ideas, but this whole village has spent the whole day working on the problem of my depression, and I am feeling incredibly cheered by it. And so then I was told that I should take with me, to just finish everything off, a packet of the millet that had been rubbed on my arms and present it in the morning to a beggar with good hearing and no deformities. And once I did that, everything would be at peace. Well, that would be the end of the story, but about 5 years later, I was doing research for my most recent book, and I was in Rwanda, and I was interviewing survivors of the genocide, and I wanted to put together their stories. And at one point, I told some people about this experience I'd had in Senegal, and the person to whom I was describing it said, oh, you know, we have rituals that are a little like that. This is East Africa, that's West Africa, it's quite different. He said, but there are some points of overlap. He said, you know, we've had a lot of trouble in this country with Western mental health workers, especially the ones who came right after the genocide. And I said, really? I said, what happened? What was the problem? He said, okay, he said, they would take people. They said, they would not put them out in the sunshine like what you've described, where people begin to feel better. There were no drums or anything to get their blood flowing faster, which is what helps you to recover. There was no element in the whole thing of the whole community coming together in support to try to all work together to solve the problem and make you feel the love of everyone around you. There was no business of describing the depression or the problems you were having as something invasive like a spirit that you could get rid of. He said, instead, they did this bizarre thing. they took people one at a time into dingy little rooms and asked them to talk for 50 minutes about bad things that had happened to them. He said, we had to get them to leave the country. Thank you.
Andrew Solomon. Ladies and gentlemen, Andrew Solomon. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is The Moth. For people who didn't know, I actually, you know what, I found myself quite by mistake sorted out my problems in a parking lot or a car park, sorry for my Luluism, in a car park of a dollar store in North Hollywood. And I was there because I had to buy 40 smiley-faced helium balloons for a party that my son was having. And I was really angry because I'm the kind of person that I suggest to have a party. And then when we have a party, then I'm mad at the fact I have to do everything. So I was standing with my 40 helium balloons in the car park of the dollar store. And I was furious and I was cursing my husband for not doing anything and me having to do stuff. And I opened the boot of the car. And it's really difficult to get 40 smiley-faced helium balloons into the trunk of a car. So I'm pushing them in, and they're coming back out. And I'm pushing them in, they're coming back out. And I'm so angry, I start punching them. And as I'm punching them, they punch me in the face. Right? So I'm standing, I'm screaming, I'm shouting at the smiley faces that are coming to smack me in the face as I am smacking them. And I stood there, I stopped and I stood there, and I was like, this is a metaphor for my whole life. All right, gorgeous one. So that was Andrew. That's it. It doesn't get deeper. So Andrew Solomon, ladies and gentlemen, his book is called In Far From the Tree. And he tells a story of parents who not only learn to deal with exceptional children, but also find profound meaning in doing so. And I know that I want to read it. So you can applaud that if you want to. So with our next storyteller, when I asked her, someone that she, the voice that she most wanted to hear and who she never wanted to hear again, she only gave me one name. She said she couldn't think of someone that she actually never wanted to hear again, but that she would really like to hear Mrs. Doubtfire. And I think that's pretty beautiful. So please welcome to the stage the gorgeous Nav Chola.
Thank you. So I go into the phone box and I put 20 pence in. And I call my boyfriend, and he answers. So I put the pound coin in, and before we begin to talk, I give him the number of the payphone so he can call me back just in case my money runs out. And just as we're about to speak, I suddenly feel the door behind me open, and a hand appears out of nowhere, and I watch it press down the switch hook of the phone. And I hear the pound coin drop to the bottom, and I watch the hand remove the coin. Earlier that evening, I'd actually been staying at my boyfriend's flat on the main university campus. He was away on work experience, and I had the keys to his flat, which was great for me because I actually lived off the main campus. But after spending a few days there, I suddenly had this urge, this yearning to go home. I wanted fresh clothes, to sleep in my own bed, hang out with my girlfriends. I just needed to go home and be in my own space. But as soon as I thought it, a voice in my head said, "Don't go." "But I want to go home." And again, the voice said, "Don't go." I wasn't really sure what to do with that. I didn't know what it meant. I mean, I was living in the city, and of course it can be a bit weird at times. But it did make me feel anxious, and so I really had to think about what I was going to do. And eventually I decided, no, I'm going to go home. But to appease the voice, I decided to remove my jewellery, remove my watch, leave my cards and my cash, but just take enough for the bus fare to get there and back the following morning and enough to call my boyfriend from the payphone. And so I set off, and it was probably about 8 o'clock in the evening. So I was living in Birmingham at the time, and it's full of subways, and certainly when I was there, it had quite the reputation for being quite seedy and unsafe, and I'd actually been flashed at a number of times down there. But this evening was different. As I walked along the subway, I saw a female police officer just ahead of me, and I remember thinking, this is a really good sign. See? I'm safe. I break my stride, so I'm almost walking in tandem with her, but without making it too obvious. And then I exit the subway, and I get to my bus stop. And the bus arrives unusually early. And again, I think this is great. Everything is flowing as it should be. I have nothing to worry about. I sit near the bus driver because I think this is the most sensible thing to do. And then I get to my stop. I'm now on the home stretch. I'm probably about 200 yards away from my flat. All I have to do now is get home. And as I start to walk, I notice a payphone on the corner. And I think to myself, I'm going to call my boyfriend from here, because the payphone on my campus is always ringing off the hook. So I think this is a great opportunity. And I remember thinking, as I walked into the phone box and felt the door close behind me, I'm safe in here. It's a box. I call my boyfriend, and before we speak, the door opens behind me, and a hand appears out of nowhere, and I watch it press down the switch hook of the phone. And I hear the pound coin drop to the bottom slot, and the hand removes the coin. I don't remember dropping the receiver, but I do remember seeing it swing from side to side. And suddenly, these arms tighten around me, and I can feel something sharp against my neck, and I'm scared. I'm so fucking scared. My heart is beating. It's beating so fast, it's pulsing in the back of my throat, and it almost feels like it could tear my throat open. And my mouth is dry, and I'm choking, and I can hardly breathe. And I can feel my legs wanting to buckle. And I keep thinking to myself, is this happening? Is this really happening to me? I think I'm told not to move or make a sound, but I can't be sure. He asks me for money, but I don't have any money. No, wait, I do. I have 75 pence. But he thinks that I'm taking the piss out of him. He pushes me up against the phone, and he grabs my bag, and now I'm panicking. I don't know how I'm going to get out. And then all of a sudden, something happened to me. I was suddenly overcome by a strange sense of calm, presence, and clarity. My senses were completely heightened, and I felt like I embodied every cell of my body. And I could feel and sense everything. And the voice in my head said, so what happens now? How does this end? So I started running through different scenarios in my mind. Maybe I'm stabbed and I die. Or maybe I'm raped, stabbed, and then I die. Or maybe I'm stabbed, but I end up in intensive care, and then I go into a coma, and then I die. And the voice said, well, it doesn't sound like you have anything to lose then. But if you do survive, the police will want a description. You need to get a description. So I raise my hands calmly, and I slowly turn around to face him. And I tell him he should check my pockets for money if he doesn't believe me. And so he does. And so I look at him, and I take the image of him in. The color of his eyes, his hair, his clothes, and the Stanley knife in his hand. He looks up and he notices the tracking movements of my eyes, and he quickly spins me around and he pushes me up against the phone. This time the grip around me is much tighter. And his hands are moving over my breasts. And the voice says, don't move. Don't even flinch. Let him touch you. Let him think he has you. And so I do. Let him touch me. And all the while, I kept thinking to myself, how did I get into the phone box? Which hand did I use to open the door? Did it open from left to right or right to left? Which hand did I use to get into the phone box? His hands are traveling downwards towards my groin. And in that moment, I decide, I'd rather die. I raise my hands and I grab his arms and I force my weight against him and push him back into the door, and I swing to my right so that I can swing to the left and use his weight to leverage the door open. And the door opens. And so I run. And then I stop running because I notice he's not chasing me. And I turn around, and I think it must have been the adrenaline running through my body, because all I can think about now is wanting to find him so I can stab him and kill him. But I can't find him anywhere. And instead, I notice an Indian man standing in the driveway of his house, watching me. I ask him, which way did he go? He says he doesn't know. And I start running down a side street, and he says, I don't think that's a good idea, and he runs after me. He asks me if I'm okay. Of course I'm not okay. I've just been mugged. He walks me back to the phone box and I pick up my bag, and the phone is replaced on the hook and it rings immediately. It's my boyfriend. I forgot. He tells me he's been ringing me for 2 minutes. 2 minutes. I hang up because I just can't talk. And the Indian man offers to drive me home. And I tell him he's crazy. I'm not getting in a car with you. You're a stranger. You're a man. He offers to bring his wife along so I feel safer. And so at the door, she comes and she insists that I wait, but that she just has to get ready and get her purse. And so while I'm waiting, every single member of the family appear at the door, wanting to know what happened, wanting to come along for the ride. Eventually, everyone is seated in the car. Everyone except me. Someone has to get out of the car so I can get into the car. The drive is excruciatingly slow, and I burst into tears. And the grandmother says to me, what are you crying for? It's not like you were raped. Oh, wait a minute, she says. He didn't touch you down there, did he? No. Well, that's all right then, because otherwise you would have been spoiled. I just want to get the hell out of here. We eventually arrive at the campus and they offer to take me back to my place and I refuse. And as the car drives off, I stand in the silence of the evening and realize I'm home. I made it home. Before, I always took my intuition for granted. And after this, I realized I don't get to negotiate with it. But I always know now that its love and its care for me is completely unconditional. Thank you.
Navreet Chawla! Navreet Chawla, ladies and gentlemen. Hey, Nav, they love your story so much, they're even doing fireworks. That was Navreet Chawla. Can you believe that, really? Is that fireworks? Is it real rain or is it pretend rain? Oh, God bless you. I just said, is it real rain or is it pretend rain? And a lovely lady down the front just went, it's real. Has it been tough? Anyway, so while we're all exploding... stopped now, isn't it? We found Nav through the folks at Spark London. And Spark London are another storytelling... can I say conglomerate? Can I say conglomerate? What does conglomerate actually mean? And actually, there's so many fireworks, they're probably just hearing con... right. Do you know what I mean? Anyway... Oh, come on! Do you know what? When I phone my husband tonight and I say, well, there were fireworks. Are you recording this for radio? Oh, you were? Does this happen every night? Is it just one guy out there with, like, some sparklers? You do like your cannons and your fire... How long are we talking? That was the best time firework ever. Right, so Spark London is another storytelling conglomerate and you can find their podcast on iTunes. You can find our podcasts at moth.com. Is it moth.com? Moth.org. Why don't you have com? What's wrong with you, man? And that's a point, actually. If you go to moth.org, because one of the things I love about the Moth, one of the things I adore about it, is that it doesn't really matter who you are. All that matters is the story. The integrity of the story is the only thing that people care about. And so if you have a story that you want to tell or you think that you could tell at the Moth, go to moth.org and there's a pitch line. And basically, you just click on it and it'll take you through the thing. And you can pitch your story on the pitch line, and if it works out, then the ladies at the Moth get in touch with you. And don't worry, they have other hosts, so you wouldn't necessarily have to work with me. Okay? There was a whole load of people going, oh, thank God for that there. So our next storyteller, when I asked them, right, I said, so, whose voice do you most love to hear? And whose voice would you never want to hear again? And he panicked, like he properly panicked in that, oh my God, how could you wait? And what he said to me was, he said, my partner Elizabeth and my kids are here tonight. Do I have to pick a favorite because I might get into trouble? So I think his favorite people are his partner Elizabeth and the kids, so he can have three, right? Any more fireworks? No, good. Can you hear me over the rain? Yes. Sorry? Yes. Thank you. All right. So please welcome to the stage. You could clap now if you wanted. just want to point out that there's nothing a storyteller likes more than silence coming on the stage. Please welcome to the stage the magnificent Rufus... Oh, God, Rufus, I forgot your name. Please, Rufus May!
So I'm in a phone box in the south of France, and I'm phoning Professor Mary Boyle. She's head of the clinical psychology doctorate at the University of East London, where I've been studying for 3 years. I've passed all the course and the placements. And she's quite an intimidating woman. She's somebody I respect greatly. She's written a book called Schizophrenia, a Scientific Delusion, and really challenging the idea that we can know anything scientific about people's intense confusion, and that we need to look in a lot more creative way at these experiences. The phone rings. She answers. But she doesn't suffer fools gladly. So I'm a little bit scared. "Hello, Mary," I say. "Hello, Rufus," she says. "Hello. I was wondering if there was a student who had had mental health problems in the past, but when he got to the course, he'd not mentioned it when he started the course. And I know it's a dismissal offence not to mention it on the occupational health form, but he just thought he might get discriminated against, so he kept quiet about it. And then he wanted to be more honest. Now he's close to qualification." She said, "Rufus, are you talking about yourself?" I said, "Oh, yes, Mary, I am." She said, "Well, it shouldn't be a problem," she said. "So what was the mental health problem?" And I said, "Well, they gave me a diagnosis of schizophrenia." "Oh, dear," she said. I was thinking, "Mary, think of your book, you know? It's a delusion." I said to her, "Look, I had some problems when I was 18. I haven't taken medication since the age of 19. And I really want to train as a psychologist. I don't have to keep this secret anymore." She said, "Rufus, you really shouldn't have lied." I said, "Well, Mary, I'm not sure I would have got to where I am today if I hadn't have lied." It was one of my more sanctimonious moments. She said, "Well, I want to support you. We want to support you, but we're going to have to take this further." So they spoke to the occupational health department, and the occupational health department said, "Well, what do you think? Do you think he's worth standing by?" And they said, "Yes, we do." And they said, "Well, we'll have to talk to his GP." So they wrote to my GP, and my GP wrote a report saying that at the age of 18, I'd had a nervous breakdown related to family-related stress, and it had had psychotic features. I thought, "Oh, that sounds good. That sounds a lot better than schizophrenia. I wish they'd have told me that at the time." What they told me at the time was that I'd have to take medication for the rest of my life, that I had this lifelong illness, and that I needed to lower my expectations of what I could achieve. I was a bit rebellious, so I didn't believe them. So I got through. I had a clean slate. I could now be open. Mary and the team supported me. And I qualified, and I got a job in East London. And I wanted to be honest, but I didn't know how to bring that part of me in. I'd hoped in psychology I could bring it in as a form of wisdom, but there never seemed a place for it. Personal experience just didn't seem to fit in there. A year later, there was a conference called Recovery, an Alien Concept. And they really wanted to hear stories of people coming through what's seen as severe mental illness. And I thought, great. So I wrote and applied to give a talk. And they took a risk. They'd never heard of me. And they took, and I got to give a talk about my journey and how I worked as a professional. I wanted to bring the two things together. how what I'd experienced in psychiatry, heavy drugs, no talking, a bit of doom and gloom, and a bit of occupational therapy, how that had influenced me and what I had found helpful and how I worked with people. So I gave this talk. And before I gave the talk, it was really important to look like I was sane. So I wore my best shirt. I did a few press-ups beforehand, a bit of yoga to look serene. And there was a woman next to me, Sandra Escher. She's like the fairy godmother of the Hearing Voices movement. The Hearing Voices movement is like a network of self-help groups for people who hear voices. She was next to me, and I told her it was my first ever talk, and she was really nice. And as I was giving my talk, there's 150 people there. I was reading out my talk, and I was talking about people who'd helped me and inspired me, and one of the people I was talking about was my mother. My mother had had a brain hemorrhage when I was 11, and together with my dad and family and friends, she'd done lots of exercises. I'd seen her make a real strong comeback from her brain hemorrhage. And I was talking about that, how it inspired me. And I paused. And Sandra Escher said, "You're doing really well." And something inside broke, and I just started to cry, which was a disaster. I wanted to appear sorted. And that's how we're trained in clinical psychology, to appear like a sanity consultant, you know? and not only was I crying, there were sobs. I couldn't speak. And I looked to the audience, to my friend, for support. And to my horror, she was crying too. So I thought, I'm going to have to leave the stage. And I just said, offhand really, someone help me out. And a guy stood up at the back and started clapping. And then everybody started clapping. And I could breathe. And the sobs subsided. And I could carry on. So I finished my speech. And I felt like I brought these two parts of my life together, the professional and the personal. And I felt like I'd spiritually come home. It was valued. Finally. And... And when I got to work after the conference, I gave the speech. I put it in the pigeonhole of everybody, so I didn't need to explain it to everybody. And obviously, I kept quiet about this, so they didn't know, and then they did know. And I would say that some of the professionals did have a problem. One or two, they were uncomfortable. One therapist said to me, "This kind of thing is best left on the therapist's couch." And somebody else was honest enough to say, "I feel really intimidated by you." And I'm sure when people do come out, they are a bit intimidating. And you're sort of suddenly, you know, mad and proud, you know. And I got a bit of a reputation, and I got a bit of media coverage, and people knew about these kind of two parts of my life often. There was some coverage of that. And I changed jobs. And a few years later, I was working in Yorkshire, and a junior doctor came to see me. Her name was Ruth. And she just wanted to meet someone, another health professional who'd also had mental health problems, and how do you manage that? We had a chat. And then a week later, she called me up to say she'd been suspended from her medical training because she'd had a period of depression 6 months before. She'd been hospitalized for a month. And she was horrified. She was so passionate about becoming a doctor. And then a week later, she phoned me up again and said, "I've started hearing a voice, and the voice is telling me to kill myself." And I said, "We better meet. I've been working a lot with self-help groups around hearing voices." And a few days later, I had a dream that I knew about a bomb being put in a grocery store, and I didn't say anything about it. And then the bomb went off, and I woke up feeling the most immense amount of guilt. And I interpreted that dream. There might be other ways to interpret that dream, but I interpreted it as that if I didn't reach out to Ruth, I was going to lose her. There's a high suicide rate amongst junior doctors anyway, and she was under tremendous pressure. She knew that if she told her doctors she heard voices, she'd definitely lose her career. She was too junior to get the support she needed. So I agreed to confidentially support her to learn how to manage the experience. And we tried lots of things. She did many different approaches, including self-help groups and using nature, using exercise. One of the things we did was I talked with her voice. And I'd only just learned this technique. And one of the tough things about voice hearing is no one else knows what you're going through. But this technique, we ask somebody to sit in a different chair and be a spokesperson for the voice. And the voice then can have a say. And so I spoke to the voice, and the voice was very angry. And I said, well, what do you want? And he said, I'm going to get Ruth to kill herself, and there's nothing you can do to stop me. And I was scared, because he was with Ruth all the time. And I said, we will resist you. Now, I'm a bit more skilled in these dialogues, and I would ask, why, you know, what pain are you holding on to that makes you so angry? You know, is there anything we can do to help you? But I didn't know how to do that stuff then. And but we didn't try to get rid of him, but we tried to strengthen Ruth so she could get on with her life. And she managed to make compromises with him so she could. And she got back onto her training. You can see voices as often carrying painful experiences, parts of people carrying terrifying experiences that have been shut away. And we need to help people both set boundaries with them, but also help those parts come to some peace. So I guess I just wanted to share those three stories, really, of finding ways to speak our truth and face our demons. So thanks very much for listening.
Rivers Law! Ladies and gentlemen, Rivers Law! So, as I've said before, the Moth is completely unscripted, and there's no notes, and it's the story. So thank you so much, Rufus. Now we're moving on to our last storyteller, but before that, I have to do my thank yous for this evening. So can I thank the people with the... Oh, thank you for standing up when I said thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the fireworks for interrupting two stories. That was awesome. I'd like to thank all of our stories. I'd especially like to thank the Wellcome Trust for supporting tonight's show. I'd like to thank Roland Gulliver, Susanna Parry, Janet Smythe, Catherine Campbell, and everybody at the Edinburgh Book Festival. And Roland, you can clap if you want, or... I'd like to thank my cold for giving me a really sore throat. I would like to thank you for not clapping that one, it's not really welcome. Everyone at Serpent's Tale, who are of course the publishing house for the Moth book, 50 True Stories. Especially Hannah Ross, Vicky Beddo, Mark Ellington, Drew Jerrison, and Hannah Westland. Matt Hill and our friends at Spark London. Our musician and timekeeper, Neil McDermott. Our producer, Sarah Austin-Junez. And the directors of tonight's show, Meg Bowles and Catherine Burns. So when I asked our last storyteller, whose voice does he want to hear again and whose voice does he never want to hear again, he said the voice he never wanted to hear again was the Geordie voice on Big Brother. I'd totally forgotten how annoying he is as well, that guy. And do you know, I have to tell you this. I know we've overrun, but I have to tell you it because it's on my mind. Today, right, because you forget when you're away. Did you get him to do that? I'm telling you anyway. Neil. I had the television on today and there was an advert for Senecott. Do you know Senecott? And it said, is your day full? I was like, what? Take Senecott, make more space in your day. And I was like, are you telling me my day's shit? Because Senecott's like a thing, isn't it? It's just a laxative. Anyway, that's the point. Anyway, so I never said I was classy. I never said I was classy. Anyway, the voice he would like to hear again is an American actor called Philip O'Brien, who always used to say, thank you for the support, I'm still waiting it. Please welcome to the stage, Omid Djalili. Omid Djalili.
Thank you, Lynn. There seems to be a developing theme of mental health issues going on here, and it reminded me, 20 years ago was my first ever Edinburgh Festival, where I did my first ever comedy show, which dealt with my own mental conflict, which was that I looked like a short, fat kebab shop owner's son. But inside me, there was a tall, thin, high-cheekboned English ponce screaming to get out, which has been the main tension of my whole life. Which is why you might have recognized me from lots of bit part movie roles where I played lots of Arabs, Arab scumbag parts, with legendary lines like, Yalla! And who can forget the great line, Walla! So that's been my life. And at a recent festival, I was asked a question, do you find it humiliating playing bit parts in big movies? And I thought this was a very difficult question because I was raised to believe that there are no such thing as bit parts. Every part is important. In fact, they say in acting, there are no small roles, only small actors, which I think we all agree with. Every role is very, 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 very important. And maybe the way you're credited sometimes is slightly mildly embarrassing. I dream of getting a name. I never have a name. I wish I could be called Roger or I think Abdul Wallah, something. But I'm usually just a name. Like in one film in Cleopatra, I was Stormmaster. And I had one line before being dragged to my death of, it wasn't me who stole the grain. That was it. Another film, I was just credited as Turkish Man. Which is pretty bad. Another film, in Notting Hill, I was cashier number two. And in one recent film, Dead Man Running, this is no joke, look it up, I'm credited as bald fat twat. Look it up. Seriously, look it up. That's actually the polite version because there were some children here. I've learned that when you do these films, there is a code. You have to learn, like as a kind of bit part actor, you have to learn to know your place. You have to be spiritually generous. Another law is never be demanding. Always do what the director wants as well, even if you don't understand. I was in a wonderful film called Casanova with the great Heath Ledger, who passed away, very lovely, wonderful. Remember Heath Ledger, who played the Joker in Batman? We were directed by Lasse Hallström, a very famous Swedish director, who goes, Omid and Heath, I want you just to be waiting, and we're going to film you for 30, just wait. So Heath Ledger was throwing a knife into a block of wood, and I was bouncing a ball. He goes, no, that's too much, too much. I want you just to stand still. He goes, action, and we just kind of stood still, looking at each other, doing that. And he goes, Omid, cut, Omid, I want you to stand and do nothing, completely nothing. I said, well, like this, because that's it. Action. Cut, he goes, can you take it down a bit? He said, that's actually true. And I did it, and he was very, very happy. So you always do what the director says. And you also learned, I also learned very importantly, is another rule is never speak unless you're spoken to. That's another big, that's kind of the ethnic bit part actor's code. I'll give you an example, if you do that, you open yourself up to being embarrassed, especially when you work with big, here's a bit of advice, never speak too much in front of the greats. Like, I was very lucky to work with Robert Redford in the film Spy Game, and I really wanted to impress him, and I said, Omid plays Arab scumbag, here's Robert Redford. So I clicked it, I said, Mr. Redford, may I say, you are the greatest actor in the world, I'm a big fan, and you are the best thing in Hawaii Five-O. It's my favorite show. In the open, you go, da-da-da-da-da-da. And he looked at me and he said, thank you, you were great in Dr. Zhivago, but you've let yourself go, which I thought was very... I thought I'd get a bigger laugh, but anyway, fine. And by the way, on that film, I had my greatest ever moment because I had to walk... It was a film with Brad Pitt and Robert Redford, and we had to walk through... to get to our scene, we had to walk through a market in Casablanca. And the film The Mummy was on all week, six times a day. And it was a time when people didn't quite know who Brad Pitt was. They saw Robert Redford saying, I know that face, I can't quite locate it. They looked at Brad Pitt, he goes, I know him from somewhere. They looked at me, he goes, fat guy from Mummy! And, and there's a wonderful picture somewhere of me surrounded by Arabs, signing autographs with Robert Redford and Brad Pitt looking back at me going, just signing away. It's a wonderful moment. But here's the story. I was very lucky to be on a film called Gladiator. I'm sure most people have seen the film Gladiator. And when I came on set, there was a very bad atmosphere. They'd been working for a week, and there was just a very tense atmosphere. And I was very nervous of Oliver Reed. There's a very famous scene where Oliver Reed grabs my nether regions and says, you sold me queer giraffes. I don't know if you remember that scene. You've got that. And... well, it was quite a tense set, and he said to me, I've got to grab your nether regions. He said, are you a method actor? I said, yes, I wasn't. He said, do you mind if I go under the tunic and actually grab your knackers to make it more realistic? And being a pro and working with a great actor, I said, by all means. So he grabbed my balls, and you sold me queer giraffes, and we stood there, and we said, fine. And usually what happens in acting, as you know, on a film set, they go, action. You do the scene where they go, cut. You've got about a minute before the next take. You can do a makeup check, have a cup of tea. They went, action. He went, grab. I was wearing sturdy underwear, but he held me. His big, thick hands held my balls, and he said, you sold me queer giraffes. And they went, cut. And when they shouted cut, he continued to hold my... And I just thought that was part of his process, so I just stood there like that, just waiting. Have a cup of tea, please. He's carried on. And take two, action. You saw me quiz. By take three, he was still holding my ball, so I started making conversation. I said, you enjoying the hotel? Is the hotel going to... Yes, you like the food there? It's fine. By take four, he was moving my testicles from left to right like that. Just, in fact, Neil, can you give me some music? Give me some music to show. Give me some epic kind of, or maybe the countdown. Give me the countdown music. This is. I'll try to include him. He's been sat there the whole time. Thank you. By the fifth take, he's still holding my balls, and I noticed that the crew are beginning to try not to laugh, and he looked at me and he says, you do know this is a wind-up, don't you? And everyone burst out laughing. They wanted to see how far they would go, and everyone started laughing, and I was proclaimed the best sport in all of Morocco. We're filming in Morocco. And everyone thought this was very, very funny, and even Branko Lustig, the big Hollywood producer who produced Schindler's List, he goes, you are very funny, you're a very funny guy. Every time I go on set, he'd push me on set and put his cigar in his mouth, go, be funny, and he'd do that international sign to be funny, go, be funny, and we're, ooh, be funny. funny guy. So I was the funny guy, and here's what happened. I got a note that I should meet the director, Ridley Scott, producer, Branko Lustig, and the writers for a very, very important meeting at dinner. Now, usually, as a bit part actor, you dinner, you keep your head down. And by the way, Omar Sharif was at he was there doing another film. And he's a very humorless man. He kept saying, why do you eat so much? I am Omar Sharif. Omar eats like a bird. I eat nothing. That's why Omar is thin and you are overweight. You are a sphere. You are a sphere. Omid Djalili is a sphere. And I said, well, when Omar Sharif walks into a snooker hall, they start chalking his head. Nothing. I got nothing. I thought it was a good joke, but nothing. So I'm sat at the main table, Ridley Scott, important meeting, and I'm all ears. And they said, Omid, you're a British comedian. I said, yes, sir. Goes, we have a big problem. Have you noticed there's a very bad atmosphere on set? I said, I've noticed it. He goes, well, it's not your fault. Russell Crowe and us, we don't get on. He's great. He's a great actor. In fact, DreamWorks is seeing the rushes, is seeing the film. He's wonderful. They're not going to sack him. But there's a very bad atmosphere. He lives away from the other actors. There's no connection between Russell Crowe and the other actors. The atmosphere and set is not conducive to a creative atmosphere. And we've been 2 weeks in, and we may have to do reshoots. We'd like you to meet Russell Crowe tomorrow and befriend Russell Crowe. We think Russell Crowe will like you. It's fine. We're going to meet tomorrow. I said, do I have a secret? You're going to meet him tomorrow in the middle of a, you know, with the small gladiator training. You're going to meet him, his assistant. We'll take you over, meet him. And if you can, become friends and get him connected with the other guys. I said, fine. I couldn't bear it. So at night, I'm thinking, a bunch of producers want me to, do they want me to actually become friends with Russell Crowe to bring the atmosphere, to actually save the movie? Apparently, I was there to save the movie. That's what they want. I'm in the mirror at home practicing as, hey, Russell, how are you doing? Hey, what happening? Yeah, I'm a fun guy. No, don't say that. Don't say I'm a fun guy. Don't snort. And just the levels of cosmic loneliness and worry was overwhelming, and I went to bed. So the next day I was driven out, and I could see. They said, we're going to meet him. And Ridley Scott and Branko Lustig, they're going to be there in the arena, watch what's going on. And I could see Russell Crowe. All the gladiators are practicing. They're doing all that kind of fighting. I could see Russell Crowe was sat on the ground concentrating. And I said, let's go and meet him. You've got the producers are all watching this. They take me over to him. They get him up. Absolutely true. They said, Russell, this is Omid playing slave trader tomorrow. Omid, this is Russell. Russell looked at me and goes, hey, how you doing, mate? You all right? I said, I'm fine. Big, strong New Zealand handshake. And he goes, I said, how you doing? He goes, yeah, it's ticking over. It's going really well, mate. You know, I look forward to working with us. Yeah, it's great. I said, Russell, I hear you live away from the other guys. And he goes, yeah, I said, maybe, you know, I'm a really fun guy. I knew that was wrong. I'm a really fun guy. I thought maybe you and me could hang out. And he says, what are you talking about? I said, no, I just hear that you live alone away. You should come to the hotel and hang out with the boys. It's really hot. We take our tops off. We play a bit of pool, a bit of ping pong. I don't know why I was moving my body around. I was doing all this stuff. And he looked really alarmed. He goes, what are you talking about? I said, nothing. Just, we can hang out and be friends. I said, oh, shit. I snorted. I snorted. A bit of pool. And he got angry, and they took him away, and I knew it was hot, and I thought it's a bit like L'Etranger, maybe I'm doing this because it's à cause du soleil, and obscure reference, those of you laughed, well done. But they took him away, and it was a very bad atmosphere, and even at lunch, he kept looking over at me, and I was still available, going, kind of going, hi, yeah, still here. And it was really bad, they took me away, and it was. I looked over, Ridley Scott had disappeared, it was a really bad atmosphere. The next day on set, Russell Crowe said, hey, mate, how's it going? I said, fine. He goes, yeah, look forward to working with you, mate. Really look forward to it. I said, what's going on? The assistant came over and said, there was a big misunderstanding yesterday. I said, what happened? He goes, well, a lot of people mistake Russell's focus for arrogance. He didn't hear you very well. When you said, like, maybe we should play pool, he thought it was a gay pass. I said, what? Because you were doing all this stuff, and he thought that the producers thought because he was alone, maybe he was gay, and maybe you were a gay sacrifice for him. You were presented to him as a gay man for him because you were doing all this, and he got offended saying, this is a big movie, and why are they thinking I'm gay? And anyway, even if I was gay, why would I sleep with a fat piece of shit like him? Anyway, what's the point? And then I left, I finished, and then the story ballooned that they said, you should have been here. There was a little short fat guy who offered himself as a companion and romantic person for Russell Crowe. And the atmosphere grew better that there was a short, fat, bald bloke who'd propositioned Russell Crowe. The atmosphere got better and everything got better. And the film won an Oscar because of me. That's all I want to say. It won an Oscar because of me. I haven't said this before. In fact, they remembered that when they won the Oscar, Branko Lustig said, I thought about, give me 1 second, Neil. I gave you a chance. They didn't thank me, but I heard later on, when they were on those post-Oscar parties, they remembered where it all started was with Oliver Reed grabbing my balls, and they all raised a toast to Omid Djalili's balls, and that's why we won the Oscar. Thank you very much. That's all. You can do it now. Thank you.
Omid Djalili. Omid Djalili, ladies and gentlemen. Every time I look at you now, I'm going to think about your balls. You know that, right? Well, we've come to the end of the evening, and I would love... Oh, you know, the other thing that I have to tell you is Omid has a book coming out, don't you? Is it out yet? Tuesday. Tuesday. It's out on Tuesday. So Omid has a book coming out. It's called Hopeful, an autobiography. Can you buy it here? No, I guess if... You can, well, you can. You can buy it here. See? There's something positive about being in a rainy tent on a Saturday night. You can buy it here. Brilliant. Anyway, we've come to the end of the evening, and I think, is this the first Moth here? Second Moth here. The second Moth ever here. So I'd like to thank you for being part of it. Go on, give yourself a round of applause. I know. You're better than that. Enjoy yourself. Thank you for being part of that. And remember, you can listen to The Moth on iTunes. And you can also go to our website, moth.org, and get on the mailing list to find out about upcoming Moth shows in the UK. And also, I would say, like, I did a thing called The Slam, which is how I got involved with The Moth. But if you've got a story to tell, really, get on the phone line, because... we'd like to hear it. And 500 people prove that people like to hear stories. So thank you very much. Thank you very much to the Book Festival, and good night.